Holy Spirit is a fickle thing. It's whimsical, joyful. It abides in a manner that is mysterious to us. Oftentimes the church is focused on emphasizing the Trinitarian aspects of our God. When we proclaim God the Creator, God the Father, God the Mother, God the Parent, God the one who births the world. We proclaim Jesus as the Christ, a man of humble origins who lived in Nazareth in Galilee and walked in dusty sandals and preached the love of God for all, including women and prostitutes, minorities, Philistines, Palestinians. There wasn't a barrier that Christ wasn't willing to cross to share the love of God. And we proclaim the Holy Spirit. And sometimes that Holy Spirit, in some way, gets a little less attention than it deserves. The Holy Spirit is a powerful metaphor, a powerful way of grace in this world. For us as the church, we experience the Holy Spirit when we celebrate baptisms. We read about Christ's own baptism when the dove descended. The Holy Spirit blessed you. And so we bless those who come here for baptism with that same Holy Spirit, open to all, whimsical and loving to all, awesome for all. The Holy Spirit also has a way of changing who we are. And that's why I think the Holy Spirit needs to get more attention than it currently gets. It deserves a lot more. See, the Holy Spirit pushes us to beyond what we think we could be as a church. And we hear about how that happened in today's scripture reading in Acts. Here, the disciples have gathered after the church has started to form, and they are with many believers who are worshiping together. And all of a sudden, on that day of Pentecost, from heaven they heard the sound of a violent wind, this whoosh. And I imagine a violent wind. Have you ever stood in the midst of a violent wind? I think that's pretty easy out here in Grand Junction to experience a violent wind. It rustles your hair, it blows your tie, that shakes your clothes, that just stands you, it leaves you standing in awe of what that wind has done to you. When I was a young minister living in Casper, Wyoming, I was in my office one day, and Casper, Wyoming is very windy, just like out here, and some days it feels like it's blowing the roof off. It was one of those windy days, and I felt that violent wind blowing all about. And so I kind of bunkered down in my office and was working on something, when the phone rang, and I answered the phone. And on the line was Robin and Vicky. And there were two women who started asking me a lot of questions about my beliefs as a minister and what my church believed. So, do you believe in Jesus? Well, yes. Do you believe in God, the Creator? Well, yes. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Yes. Now, I get some of those calls every now and then of people calling and talking to me. They want to find out the legitimacy of a church that proclaims itself to be open and affirming, that proclaims that we have a wide welcome to all of God's people, regardless of who you are. And so I was used to these kinds of phone calls, and I thought at the very end of it I was going to get some sort of, well, you're going to go to hell because you're not preaching the Word of God. But that was not what had happened on that phone call. Instead, they ask, do you believe that two women can get married and have a loving and gracious relationship? I said, yes. Yes, I do. And they pause, and you could hear the stillness over the phone, and you could hear the stillness outside of the church. The wind had calmed down, and it was no longer violent. Peace had settled upon all of us. And they said, well, we're two lesbians, And we heard about this United Church of Christ from a commercial, from being on the internet. And it said that you believe that we have God's love too, and that we can be in your church. And then they proceeded to tell me that they were so excited as soon as they heard that. They got in their car and they drove to a church. And the church was the Church of Christ, which is not the same as the United Church of Christ. In fact, we're probably on a different theological spectrum. Well, these two women, they walked into that church and they were so happy to have found a place that was going to love them and accept them for who they were. And they started talking with the minister, and the minister was very gracious at first. And then when they mentioned that they were looking for a minister who would be willing to marry them, the minister, they said, you could just see it registered on him finally that this was a lesbian couple. And the anger in him turned him red. He was furious, and he yelled at them, and he screamed at them, and he chased them out of that church. And he threw the doors closed and locked them. And these two women were stunned, and they went back and they sat in their car and they got on their phones and they looked up the United Church of Christ before, because they're like, this is not the church that we thought we were going to. Well, they pulled up another address, which was First Congregational United Church of Christ in Casper. And they drove over and called me on the phone. And they said, well, if it's okay, we'd like to come in and talk with you, Pastor. And I said, sure, yeah, we'll set up a time that you can come and do that. And they said, well, actually, we're in your parking lot right now. And I opened the curtain, and there they were, sitting right in their car in front of my office window. And they waved at me from their car. And at that moment, having heard their story and knowing how much it would mean to them, I threw the phone down, and I walked up, and threw the doors of the church wide open, the front doors, and I walked up to their car, and I walked them into our sanctuary. And we sat in the sanctuary, and we talked about faith and love and God's transforming power. And we talked about the love of God that is for all people. And we went ahead and had a wedding, and it was glorious and wonderful and awesome. And their family and friends came up and said, we didn't know there was a church that was as open and welcoming for all people as this one. I think when we boldly proclaim God's love and grace, that even passes my understanding, we find ourselves in some tricky situations sometimes. Sometimes defending ourselves to others, just like those disciples did on the day of Pentecost, when the people who were outside of the church looked upon those who were speaking in tongues, speaking in their own languages, speaking in many different languages, and they said, well, that's not the real church. That's just a bunch of goofballs. They don't know what they're talking about. They're just being silly. Maybe they're even intoxicated. And Peter said, instead of him saying no, I imagine him saying yes. Yes, we are intoxicated with the Holy Spirit. But we know what we're talking about. We're a church beyond the walls of this building. We're a church beyond what the old guard of the church believes. We're a church that is transformed and becoming new. We are a new church. And with the grace and guidance of the Holy Spirit, we will continue to be the new church on into the future. So regardless of who we are, we're defending ourselves to people who say, oh, you're being silly. There is no way that that is Christianity, that it can be so welcoming and gracious and loving. That's not the Christianity I am. We find ourselves defending what we believe about the love of God, that all people, LGBTQ, lesbian, gay, transgender, bisexual, queer folk, pansexual, no sexual awareness at all, whatever it is, that you are welcome here in this place. Regardless of if you are a Bible-believing creationist or a scientist who understands the foundations of evolution to be the formative experience of your life, and you defend climate change and our ability to protect this planet by all we can do with your last dying breath, you are welcome here. No matter if you are a two-year-old who has no sense of personal space and runs around the church, or you're using a walker and every ounce of strength it takes to get into these pews each Sunday, you are welcome here. No matter the color of your skin, the timbre of your voice, the way that you express yourself, what you wear, you are welcome here in this place. Because that, my friends, is the power of the Holy Spirit that is always and forever breaking through in our world. I was reading a reflection this week by Reverend Emily Heath, who was thinking about how Pentecost had come and had given all those who were in that space the Holy Spirit and the power to speak other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. And she says, sometimes she feels like the church gets it a little wrong. They miss the point. That in Acts, the people around the disciples do not suddenly learn to speak the disciples' language, i.e. the language of the church. It's the other way around. The Holy Spirit gives the disciples the ability to speak the languages of the people gathered around them. They were amidst an international crowd with many different languages, and they could suddenly communicate with everyone. She tells a story about how one of her friends was in church one day on Facebook, and she had Facebook open and was checking in on Facebook saying, "Hey, I'm at this church. I'm here." And a lady sitting next to her kind of gave her a glance and said, "Phones are not for worship." But that check-in on Facebook sent a message out beyond the church's walls, telling friends and neighbors, "Hey, this is my church. You would be welcome here too, no matter who you are, no matter where you are on your life's journey." Our ways of communicating are changing every day. Our ways of having language as a tool for sharing the mercy, grace, and love of God are ever expanding. Things like Facebook and Twitter and other platforms, these are things that call us to a Pentecost moment, a way of going beyond who we are now and finding ways that we can listen to the world and speak that language and use that language to share the love and grace and mercy of God. It's not about the language that we know here in this building, the language of the church. It's about learning God's love languages. And that's how we become a new church, ever growing, ever expanding, ever being gracious, and always sharing the Holy Spirit, the grace, and the awesomeness, that wind chime being that spreads its love amongst us this day. This is my prayer for all of us, always. For this is a God that I will worship all the days of my life. Amen. Amen.